3 days and it's just a shooting, but give it time, okay? This place is fantastic. It's like Gone with the Wind on mescaline.
A murder case involves the rich and the kinky, as well as the spiritual, and Clint Eastwood's film of the bestseller Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil. One of four new movies we'll be reviewing this week on Siskel and Ebert, in addition to an analytical look at the film career of Michael Douglas. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Our first film is the second bestseller in a row film by Clint Eastwood, coming after his successful Bridges of Madison County. And this is another major success. Eastwood's accomplishment this time is that he achieves a remarkable balance in juggling so many different characters, ably scripted by John Lee Hancock from John Barron's book. John Cusack stars as a New York writer assigned to write a magazine article about the annual Christmas party given by an antiques expert, a wheeler dealer, and power broker in Savannah, Georgia, played deliciously by Oscar winner Kevin Spacey, who has been turning in one terrific character performance after another.
I was born in Gordon, Georgia, a little town outside of Macon. My father was a barber, sometime house builder. My mother was a secretary. What money I have is about 11 years old. So, yes, I am nouveau riche, but then it's the riche that counts now, isn't it?
Well, Cusack is intrigued, and so are we. And the more Savannah natives he meets, the more the writer in him wants to stick around, and we do too. Here, for example, a couple of dog walkers with only one dog between them.
Patrick do love his morning walk.
The story is based on real people and events in Savannah, and there's a transvestite in this story played by the real transvestite known as the Lady Chablis.
Now, Chablis is a pretty name. It's unusual.
Why, thank you. I got it off a wine bottle.
And there's a pretty young woman on the make, too, played by Clint Eastwood's daughter, Allison.
Thirsty?
Me? No, not really.
If you're thirsty, a drink will cure it. And if you're not, a drink will prevent it. Prevention is better than a cure.
You see what I mean about juggling all these characters? Clint Eastwood does a good job. It's so well done. It almost doesn't matter that I haven't mentioned the centerpiece of this film, which is a murder trial. And think about it. It's a rare picture that doesn't need its conventional main story point to be entertaining. This is a screenplay worth studying because it overflows with riches, as does Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil.
I was disappointed in the film, Gene. I felt, first of all, that it was flat and slow, and secondly, it made the mistake of focusing all the information through the Cusack character, who is very bland, an enigma, a very drab person. I think that the people in Savannah, who the real writer wrote about, are much more interesting, and the fact that they all have to focus everything they say and do through that character is a mistake.
I think he's intrigued as a writer in all of these people, and that intrigue I felt, Roger.
I was intrigued by them. I mean, I've read the book, and
And maybe there is a big difference.
Maybe so. Maybe that's it, because if you've read the book, you're going to find this to be kind of pale by comparison. And also, it's a disappointment that the screenplay structures everything in terms of the murder courtroom formula, when in fact the book is much more anecdotal and all over town.
And I think the picture works if you took the whole courtroom thing out of it. That's how interesting I think these characters are.
Okay, our next film also deals with the way death sends ripples through a small town, but few films could be more different from Midnight and the Garden of Good and Evil than The Sweet Hereafter. This is the dark, brooding, mysterious film by Adam Egoyan about a school bus that slides off the road and falls through the ice, and about how a lawyer who has troubles of his own slowly penetrates the secrets of the people he wants to use as witnesses. The lawyer is played in a great performance by Ian Holm. Early in the film, he takes a collect call from his daughter, who he knows with great sadness is a drug addict who could die herself at almost any time.
What's the matter with wanting to talk to you, Daddy?
Nothing's wrong with trying to talk to me, Zoe.
Well, then what's the problem?
The problem is I don't know who I'm talking to right now.
In a flashback, we see two of the parents in a snowbound Canadian town taking their child to the doomed school bus.
Beautiful snow we're having, eh, Dolores?
Oh, it's just a flurry, Hartley. It's totally clear up ahead.
The parents are played there by Arseny Kanjian and Earl Pastko, and the lawyer has a strained conversation with them after the death of their son.
If everyone had done their job with integrity, your son would be alive and safely in school this morning. I promise that I will pursue and reveal who it was did not do their job.
The Sweet Hereafter follows the lawyer on his journeys through the secrets of the town, but this is not a movie about courtrooms or investigations. It's about sadness, about how a tragedy occurred, and no one can make sense of it or find an appropriate way to react to it, except for one girl who, in a stunning scene, reduces everything to an issue in her own life. The Sweet Hereafter won the grand prize at Cannes this year, and I agree, it's one of the year's best films.
And he's one of the most interesting filmmakers we have around, and this comes, if you know his work, this is a surprise.
Yes, it is.
Come from him.
Yes.
It's been said, and I grew up with this from my family, you know, that there's nothing worse than losing a child. It's life out of order. People, we all know, sadly, people never adjust to this. Mm-hmm. To take on that subject matter and to find some peace, mm-hmm. some meaning in this thing that has no meaning, mm-hmm. is a spectacular achievement.
It's so original, and a lot of the credit should go to Russell Banks, the author of the novel. It's interesting that the lawyer is not seen as an ambulance-chasing fee-grabber, but as a guy who almost finds himself in the same mood as the people he comes to this town to represent, so that they're all wandering in kind of a frigid northern mist of grief and confusion.
Here the emotional blood is there, and the healing process somehow does begin. It's fascinating.
Yes, it does.
Coming up later, Michael Douglas talks about what attracts him to his cutting-edge role.
I generally like pictures, you know, about moral ambiguities, because I think we deal with them every day.
And coming up next, Godfather director Francis Ford Coppola tackles another bestseller, John Grisham's The Rainmaker.
Better watch your back. So what do you want? You want a continuance?
No, Your Honor. I am prepared to argue this motion.
A young attorney takes on veteran lawyers there defending an evil insurance company in the film version of John Grisham's The Rainmaker, directed by no less than Francis Ford Coppola. And the discovery here is a fresh young talent, actor Matt Damon, who was a battle-scarred medic in Courage Under Fire, and here plays a new attorney in Memphis who applies to work at a meat and potatoes firm headed by a lawyer with ties to the mob, played by a barely recognizable Mickey Rourke.
You get the paperwork on this stuff?
In my car.
Okay. Hey, good looking. This is Dex Shepard. This man will get you plugged in.
The young law school graduate is shown the ropes how real law is practiced in the real world by a shifty paralegal played by Danny DeVito. I wish his character were the central one in this movie. He's that much fun.
In law school, Rudy, they don't teach you what you need to know. It's all theories and lofty notions and big fat ethics books.
What's wrong with ethics?
Nothing, I guess.
The young attorney's first major litigation is a doozy. He's handling a case where a giant insurance company won't pay the claim of a working-class woman whose son needed a bone marrow transplant for leukemia. The lead attorney for the insurance company, John Voight.
I'm curious. About what? I'm just wondering. Do you even remember when you first sold out?
The Rainmaker is a pretty straightforward piece about legal theory and practice. Idealism versus reality, no surprise there. I'm giving the film only a slightly positive review because the script doesn't have any surprises. It's the acting that's so good. The director Coppola, with his reputation, he's attracted a terrific cast and I think a modest story. A marginal recommendation for me for John Grisham's The Rainmaker.
I liked it too, and I was surprised that this movie, unlike some of Grisham's stuff, is really very down on the law. By the end of the movie, you wonder if the guy even wants to be a lawyer anymore. Another thing I noticed, often in a Grisham film, there'll be a really high-priced lead, and he'll be in practically every scene. Here, you have the richness of a very varied selection of character actors. And all of these supporting performances bring life to the story.
It's standard.
I was interested in the machinations of the insurance company and the way that Virginia Madsen comes in at the end and exposes things. She has a real good courtroom.
Okay. Coming up next, what exactly is the significance of Michael Douglas's movie career? A critical conversation with Michael Douglas when we come back. And now it's time for an occasional feature on this program, The Revolving Thumb, where Roger or I or both of us take a look at an important person, theme, or issue in today's movies. And my subject this week is actor and producer Michael Douglas, who recently received a Career Achievement Award at this year's Chicago International Film Festival. But that didn't get me to start thinking about his career. Why not? Because I've been thinking about his career for at least a decade, back to 1987, when he began starring in one socially relevant film after another about successful men and the critical issues in their lives. If Jack Nicholson was the essential male actor of the 70s, and he certainly was, Michael Douglas is, I think, the essential guy for the late 80s and 90s, the me and money decades. I spoke to him just before he received his award.
I guess for my generation, you know, and for you, really it started with the Vietnam War, where things were no longer black and white. After World War II, you know, you had the enemy, and it was very clear who the enemy was. It was good guys and bad guys. Now, after the Vietnam War, it was this gray area. Television and the number of stations and information make it much more of a mixture. But I like that mixture. I'm interested in those kind of gray areas.
Indeed, for love or money, look at his film, The Terror of Casual Sex in Fatal Attraction.
What are you doing? Please, Dad, please don't go. I didn't mean it. Please, I'm sorry. I'll tell your wife.
You tell my wife, I'll kill you.
Money, his Oscar-winning role in Wall Street.
Greed, for lack of a better word, is good.
Sexual politics in the workplace? Disclosure. I didn't like the picture that much, but Douglas's sense of hot-button issues is uncanny.
I want to know whether I can sue her for sexual harassment.
With our national divorce rate approaching 50%, he stars in the best divorce movie ever, The War of the Roses.
And you better get yourself a damn good lawyer.
Best your money can buy.
I think male roles are pretty confused these days in terms of what their identities are. I think that the women's movement was very clearly defined. I don't think men knew exactly how to respond to it. I think there's now some confusion in that movement and realizing that, you know, all of a sudden two-income houses were a prerequisite. It wasn't like a luxury. And nobody's home. There's nobody home. And it's gotten difficult. It's gotten difficult for a lot of kids and difficult for marriages.
What's a picture where you said, that's a performance, that's a role that really is an insight into what it means to be a man today?
I guess Falling Down, that was a character who seemed to be have done everything that was correct, was very patriotic, supported his country, worked in the defense industry, and with the end of the Cold War, had no job.
I'm overeducated, underskilled. Maybe it's the other way around, I forget. And I'm obsolete.
Where does Douglas come to this remarkable level of social awareness? Here's an answer close to my heart and Roger's as well.
I read four papers a day. All right, I'm a big newspaper guy, so I'm up on current events. And hopefully, you know, you keep your humane spirit.
And he explains his ability to produce socially conscious films from the get-go of his career this way. Films like The China Syndrome, or his 5 Oscar-winning production of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
I just do what I like, you know. I've been really fortunate. Streets of San Francisco gave me the financial security that I could then make, you know, whatever pictures I want to make.
Now, if you were to ask most people, maybe even most film critics, to name the important actors of the past 10 years, I don't know how many people would name or even think of Michael Douglas. Born to Hollywood royalty, exceptionally good-looking. Maybe that keeps him from being thought of as an artist. But over the last 10 years, I don't think any other American actor has been more topical about what successful contemporary men want and what they fear. So for me, the revolving thumb points up for Michael Douglas, a man who has his finger on the pulse of American manhood.
Well, there are probably some other actors you could also mention on the same list, but one interesting thing about Douglas, and I think he got part of this from his father, Kirk, is that he's very smart. He's a well-read, studied person who is interested in bringing projects to Hollywood instead of simply allowing himself to be cast. He's got that producer gene, and you've got to do that to be an actor today, because you can't wait for somebody to come to you with this stuff. You've got to originate it. You've got to know what it is you want to do, and as a producer actor, he's unique.
The issue that you're talking about is that the studio system has died, so the studio executives are not caring for you. Everybody's his own, every major talent is his own studio, and this guy the producer gene is a good word to say that he's got.
Okay, when we come back, Deep Crimson, about a couple who meet through the singles ads and find they have something in common, murdering other people who answer singles ads. The Mexican director Arturo Ripstein has made 24 films over the past 32 years and become probably Mexico's most important director, without attracting much attention, unfortunately, in the United States. His new film, Deep Crimson, is a fascinating exercise in romantic obsession, based on the true case of a couple who met through the Lonely Hearts ads and found that although they were not well matched for love, they were naturals at victimizing other Lonely Hearts advertisers. Here they are, played by Regina Orozco and Daniel Jimenez Cacho, after their first night of love. He's a thief who's been faking his passion. But this woman is not easy to get rid of, and soon she's dumped her children in an orphanage to clear the way for their relationship.
No soy buena madre. Soy mejor amante, ¿no?
They make a deadly team. He seduces women who write into the personal ads, and she's the evil inspiration that makes him capable of more violence than he could have possibly committed by himself. He courts and even marries some of the victims, and all of their partners in deception, his accomplice has attacks of jealous rage. Arturo Ripstein is sometimes coldly merciless in depicting their murder spree, and sometimes so cynical about human love and behavior that a dark, Buñuelian humor shines forth. Deep Crimson is the kind of movie that hasn't been smoothed out, dumbed down, or made conventional. It's the real thing.
And Roger, I'm the guy that's been knocking one serial killer movie after another from the United States, and this is, if you think about it, a serial killer story, but it's completely different, just as you said. It's different because we don't have the conventional scene where the detective tells the MO and we have all the clues. You see how manipulative that is, why I hate those pictures so much? Because they're not about the nature of what they pretend to be about. This is saying, here's what they get off on. Here's where combustion takes place between these two people, these two twisted people, these two cauterized emotionally people, and it produces murder. And it's fascinating in that way.
I haven't seen you so worked up about a movie in a long time.
Because it proves the case of these other pictures that I've been knocking. And the best criticism, as Godard said, is to make another film. And this is the film that says that the American serial killer movies are cheap exploitation.
Okay, Deep Crimson, and it's rolling out around the country in our theaters. You have to look for it. It's worth looking for. When we come back, my video pick of the week, a new magazine on video that includes Oscar-winning short subject.
Now it's my turn to play ball.
On November 26th, America gets its first taste of flubber.
Mommy.
Robin Williams, Flubber, rated PG.
Siskel and Ebert's video pick of the week is brought to you by Nestle Raisinettes. At the movies or at home, Raisinettes.
We're both often asked, how come there never seems to be an opportunity to see good short films, even those that win the Academy Awards? They sure don't play in theaters. Well, there are a lot of answers to that question, but one of them is my video pick of the week, a new project called Short Cinema Journal that's released on the new DVD video format. This is a video disc that contains more than 2 hours of short films spanning a wide range of material. For example, this Oscar-nominated animated short is called The Big Story. It's about the newspaper world. We talk about Michael Douglas. Here is Kirk Douglas. And Kirk Douglas. And Kirk Douglas.
What a rotten, stinking world. You guys are all the same.
A lot of people have heard that Billy Bob Thornton's Sling Blade was a short subject before it was a feature film. The Short Cinema Journal includes that short subject with Molly Ringwald as a reporter and Thornton already completely in character.
I reckon reason I'm in here is because I killed somebody. But I reckon what you're wanting to know is how come me to kill somebody, so I reckon I'll start at the front and tell you.
We reviewed this format a few months ago, and Gene and I found it dramatically superior to videotapes and even noticeably better than laser discs. Now it's good to see that a lot more titles have been released on DVD from more and more studios, including the Short Cinema Journal, my video pick of the week. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed on this show. We split on Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil. I thought it had great characters, but badly needed organization. Gene, however, feels it's another major success for director Clint Eastwood. Two very admiring thumbs up for Adam Egoyan's The Sweet Hereafter, the heartbreaking portrait of a town in the process of emotional collapse. Two thumbs up for John Grisham's The Rainmaker, directed by Francis Ford Coppola, with a rich array of colorful supporting characters. And two thumbs way up for Arturo Ripstein's bizarre, merciless, deep crimson about a romantic obsession that feeds on crime.
So a couple of titles that people have never heard of and aren't going to be advertised a lot in this high-pressure pre-holiday season, Sweet Hereafter and Deep Crimson.
That's right. Remember, you can check out our votes and hear our reviews of recent movies at our website. The address is Siskel-Ebert.com. That's it for this week. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including Alien Resurrection, with Winona Ryder joining Sigourney Weaver in the latest installment of the science fiction series, and also Flubber, starring Robin Williams as the most absent-minded of inventors. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
In a recent taste challenge, 3 out of 4 consumers preferred Jolly Time popcorn over all others. Maybe the fourth never got a real taste. Jolly Time popcorn. Taste the fun.
You'll race to unravel the world's greatest brain teasers with 30-second mysteries. Discover the excitement and intrigue of 30-second mysteries today. 30-second mysteries from University Games.
With a home equity loan from the Money Store, you can consolidate bills, make home improvements, even buy a car. Call the Money Store at 1-800-LOAN-YES.
Tooth whiteners, mouthwashes, breath mints, plaque fighters, and chewing gum? Forget them. All you need is Yow, the revolutionary new breath freshener that whitens teeth and fights bad breath.